Welcome to nonstopneuron.com, where learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. In this video, we will talk about the analysis of cardiac output and venous return curves. First, we will study both curves separately, and then we will put them together. So let's get started. First, the cardiac output curve. It shows the relationship between right atrial pressure and cardiac output. This curve is for normal situations without any nervous influence. Normal cardiac output is about 5 liters per minute at right atrial pressure of about 0 millimeters of mercury. By the heart's intrinsic mechanisms, the cardiac output can be increased up to 13 liters per minute. However, under sympathetic stimulation, the same right atrial pressure results in even more increase in cardiac output. The maximum cardiac output that can be achieved also increases. Thus, the curve is shifted up. The same is also seen when we give positive ionotropic agents like cardiac glycosides. On the other hand, inhibition of sympathetic activity and pathological conditions like arrhythmia, cardiac hypoxia, myocarditis, etc. decreases cardiac output for each level of right atrial pressure. Thus, the curve is shifted down. Now let's see the effect of changes in external pressure on the heart. See, the pressure in the chest cavity compresses the heart. An increase in this pressure opposes the filling of the cardiac chambers. And we know that according to Frank Starling mechanism, the lesser the filling, the lesser the cardiac output. To overcome this, the right atrial pressure also needs to increase. In short, to achieve the same cardiac output, we now need more right atrial pressure. In the graph, this appears as a shift towards the right. This curve is for normal intrapleural pressure. Here, the normal cardiac output was achieved at right atrial pressure of about 0 millimeters of mercury. Now let's say the intrapleural pressure increases by 4 millimeters of mercury. In this case, the same filling of heart chambers would happen at 4 mmHg higher right atrial pressure. So now, to achieve 5 liters per minute cardiac output, the right atrial pressure needs to be 4 millimeters of mercury instead of 0. The same happens for all the values of cardiac output. If everything else is the same, even the same maximum cardiac output can also be achieved at increased right atrial pressure. Thus, the curve shifts to the right. Such shift is seen in case of positive pressure ventilation, opening of thoracic cage, etc. In a nutshell, increasing external pressure on the heart shifts the curve to the right. On the other hand, a decrease in external pressure has an opposite effect, so the curve shifts to the left. For example, during breathing against a negative pressure. So this was about the cardiac output curve. Now let's talk about the venous return curve. To study it, we will use this simplified model of circulation. Think of it as a tube of a cycle tire, the shape of which is modified to represent the circulation. This graph shows the pressure in different parts of the circuit. In the beginning, it is empty. So, the pressure inside is zero. Now we fill it with the blood, which generates some pressure. Such filling of our blood vessels produces the pressure of about 7 millimeters of mercury. Please note that this pressure would be uniform throughout the circuit. Now, we also fit a pump here that represents the heart. The pumping activity of the heart pushes the blood to the artery side. So, the pressure over here increases. At the same time, pulling blood from the venous side decreases the pressure in this area. Thus, now we have a pressure gradient from arteries to veins. This gradient drives the flow of blood along the circuit. The more the speed of the pump, the more the gradient, and the more the flow. Here, this portion of the circuit right before the pump represents the right atrium. And the venous return curve basically shows the relationship between pressure in this area and blood flow at different speeds of the pump. If you have understood this model, let's see the curve now. It shows right atrial pressure on the x-axis and venous return on the y-axis. When the pump is off, the pressure is 7 millimeters of mercury and venous return is obviously zero. As we turn the pump on, the suction of blood from the right atrium decreases the pressure there. So on the x-axis, the point moves towards the left. And also, blood starts to returning to the pump. So venous return rises from zero. So this is a new position now. If we increase the speed, which is representative of increasing cardiac output, there would be even more suction. So there will be a further fall in the pressure and increase in venous return. So the point moves further to the left and upward. This keeps happening up to a limit. At negative pressures, the wall of the veins starts getting sucked up together. So there is no further increase in venous return, no matter how much the right atrial pressure falls. Thus we get such venous return curve. At a normal level of pumping in our body, the right atrial pressure is about 0 millimeters of mercury and venous return is about 5 liters per minute. If pumping by the heart decreases, the pressure in the right atrium increases due to loss of the suction effect. And if the heart stops completely, the pressure reaches about 7 millimeters of mercury. This pressure is due to the filling of the vessels with the blood, as we have seen in the beginning. It's uniform throughout the circuit and it's called mean systemic filling pressure. So this is the venous return curve that we get under normal circumstances. Now let's see what happens if the blood volume is increased. With the increase in blood volume, the tightness in the vessel increases. This increases the baseline pressure when the pump is off. For the body, it means an increase in mean systemic filling pressure. In simple words, if blood volume is high, the pressure in the vessels increases even if the heart is not functioning. Here also, as we increase the speed of the pump, the right atrial pressure keeps decreasing and venous return keeps increasing. The plateau is also reached the same way due to the collapse of venous valves. But this plateau is higher than the previous because more blood is creating more pressure in the veins. So more blood tends to return to the heart at every level. Thus, the curve is shifted up when we increase the blood volume. At lower blood volumes, the opposite is seen. This means mean systemic filling pressure decreases and the curve shifts downwards. So these are the effects of changing blood volume on venous return curve. Now let's talk about the effect of changing the tone of the blood vessels. First, we will talk about the veins. With increasing sympathetic tone, the veins compress the blood inside. So the baseline pressure is increased. Also, now due to increased tone, the venous return increases for all the levels of right atrial pressure. In short, the curve shifts up. Thus, increase in venous tone is similar to increasing blood volume, but the mechanism in this case is different. Now, decreasing the venous tone has the opposite effect. Mean systemic filling pressure will decrease and there will be a decrease in venous return for all the levels of right atrial pressure. This one is similar to a decrease in blood volume. So these were the effects of changing venous tone. These effects were relatively simple to understand. But there are more twists when we talk about the effects of arteriolar tone. First, the arteries have a very small amount of blood as compared to the veins. So compressing them does not produce much changes in baseline pressure in the entire system. So the mean systemic filling pressure stays near the same 7 mmHg pressure. Thus the point remains near the same location on the x-axis. Next, we know that heart generates the pressure and then we have a pressure gradient from arteries to vein that drive the flow of blood. But when arteries are constricted, less pressure is transmitted from arteries to veins. So venous pressure decreases at every right atrial pressure. And there is a corresponding fall in venous return too. Thus, the curve becomes less steep if there is an increase in arteriolar tone. A decrease in arteriolar tone also does not affect the mean systemic filling pressure much. But now, more pressure is transmitted to veins. So venous return increases. Thus, the curve becomes more steep if there is a decrease in arteriolar tone. To summarize the changes in venous return curve, changing blood volume or venous tone shifts the venous return curve up or down, and changing arteriolar tone affects its slope. Please note that we discussed the different situations separately to keep the discussion simple. But in most cases, multiple things are happening at the same time. So this was all about the venous return curve. Now let's put the cardiac output curve and venous return curve together in the same graph. The point where both these curves intersect is the equilibrium point. This is the equilibrium point under normal resting condition. Here, the cardiac output and venous return is 5 liters per minute and right atrial pressure is about 0 millimeters of mercury. See, usually when we draw such graphs, we have one independent variable shown on one axis and the other is a dependent variable which is shown on the other axis. But in this graph, none is absolutely dependent or independent variable. Cardiac output, venous return, and right atrial pressure all depend on each other. This might make this graph a bit tricky to understand. If you are having the same issue, don't worry, just follow me. The equilibrium point in this graph moves only if there is a permanent change in the shape of any of the curves. Otherwise, the deviations are only transient and small. For example, imagine that by doing some magic, you increase the mean arterial pressure out of nowhere in this normal condition. So what would happen is, due to an increase in right atrial pressure, the cardiac output will increase due to the Frank-Starling mechanism. And at the same time, the venous return will also decrease. So immediately after you do the magic, there will be a mismatch between cardiac output and venous return for a brief period. But this imbalance cannot last very long. Obviously, the heart cannot pump like 12 liters of blood if it's receiving only 4 liters of it. So, this gets corrected automatically. What happens is, an increase in cardiac output sucks the blood from the right atrium. So, the pressure there starts decreasing. And also, the increased cardiac output increases venous pressure as well. Both of these increase the pressure gradient for venous return. So, venous return increases. Also, as the right atrial pressure falls, the role of the Frank-Starling mechanism also starts to fall. So, the cardiac output also starts decreasing. This way, the right atrial pressure keeps decreasing, venous return keeps increasing, and cardiac output keeps decreasing until the equilibrium is achieved. Thus, without shifting the curves, we cannot bring about long-lasting changes in the equilibrium. And this brings us to the long-lasting changes. As we saw earlier, changes in the sympathetic stimulation of the heart and blood vessels, changes in blood volume, various diseases, etc. can bring about changes in the shape of these curves. So they bring about permanent changes in these parameters. Let's take a few examples. One is blood transfusion. When we give blood transfusion to someone, the blood volume increases. This shifts the venous return curve upwards as we saw earlier. So now, cardiac output and venous return are increased. And this happens at increased right atrial pressure. The second example, giving positive inotropic agents like cardiac glycosides. They shift the cardiac output curve upwards. So here also, cardiac output increases, but this time it happens at a lower right atrial pressure. The third example, the increased sympathetic activity causes an upward shift in the cardiac output curve by increasing the contractility of the heart, and it also shifts the venous return curve upward by causing generalized venous constriction. So venous return and cardiac output both increases without much change in right atrial pressure. We can study such changes for a wide variety of situations, but you got the basics now. Now let's have a quick summary. The cardiac output curve and venous return curve depict the changes in respective parameter with changing right atrial pressure. Venous return and cardiac output can be equal at only one point where both the curves intersect each other. sympathetic stimulation, positive inotropic agents, etc., shift the cardiac output curve upwards. Inhibition of sympathetic activity, negative inotropic agents, and certain diseases move this curve downwards. An increase in intrapleural pressure shifts the curve to the right, and a decrease shifts it to the left. Talking about venous return curve, an increase in blood volume and increased venous tone shifts it upwards, and decrease in blood volume and venous tone moves the curve downwards. An increase in arteriolar tone decreases the slope of the curve, and decrease in the arteriolar tone increases the slope. By putting these curves together, we can analyze changes in these parameters in different conditions. That's it for the analysis of cardiac output and venous return curve. Now, today's bonus point is only for those who are still not able to understand the graphs. I want to tell you two things. One, see, usually when we study graphs, the relationship between parameters on x-axis and y-axis is straight. One factor depends on the other. So here, you intuitively know from where to start and where to go. However, in this case, the relationship between these parameters is not straightforward. They all depend on each other. So you cannot find a stable point from where you can start understanding the changes. So if you are struggling to understand these concepts, don't feel bad. It's not a problem with you. And second, even though I have tried my best to make it easy for you, if you are still struggling, just let it go. Because you have all the baseline knowledge to understand these concepts, you are tempted to learn this. But practically, understanding these concepts will not help you understand other concepts any further. At least that is the case for me. I personally don't find this analysis useful clinically. But if you think otherwise, please let me know in the comments. Maybe I can learn something from you. That's it for this video. Please hit all the YouTube buttons that you find beneath this video. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.